Well, those joining right now, we'll get started in just a minute. Thank you everyone for joining. We're gonna get started in just a minute as we're waiting for to give some participants a little bit of time to join the call so they don't miss anything. Okay, so we'll get started. Hello, everyone. I'm Cynthia Hirsch. I am the International President of the Retail Design Institute and a member of the Shop Board of Directors. Welcome to the first co-sponsored event between two great organizations that I'm proud to belong to. Today, we will be presenting award-winning store design and POP projects. I will showcase 10 highlights from the Retail Design Institute's 49th awards. Ryan Brevda of Ryan Scott Displays and a member of Shop Board of Directors will showcase awards from the Shop OMA Awards. And Leo van de Polder, Shop's Global Development Director, will highlight the Global Awards. And I'd like to say a quick thank you to the Retail Design Institute Ohio chapter for hosting the judging of the Retail Design Institute 49th Awards. So first, I'd like to introduce Ryan Brevda, Ryan Scott Displays, and Shop Board of Directors.
Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon, everybody.
And Leo van de Polder of Shop's Global Development.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening.
After our presentation, we will be joined by award winners Stefan Bernier of Edifica, Brian Weltman of RHDC Studio, Pablo Braga of Chel Latam, Dan Sabinosh and Rhonda Foster of Great Northern In-Store, and Henrik Anderson of In-Store Screen. They will be here to answer your questions. So feel free, if you have questions as we're going through, to put them into the Q&A at the bottom of your screen. Without further ado, I will get started with the Retail Design Institute 49th International Design Awards. First up, we have Birkenstock in Venice, done by TPG Architecture. Fido of Montreal, done by Callison RTKL. Innisfree of Seoul, done by Mapos Architects. Maitri in Pittsburgh, done by the High Road Design Studio. Moulton Brown in Dartford, done by Dalziel and Powell. Nordstrom, New York City, done by Nordstrom Store Design in collaboration with James Carpenter and Callison RTKL. Psycho Bunny in Miami, done by Edifica. Specs in Del Mar, done by Retail Habitats, also known as RHDC. Timberland in London, done by Dalziel and Powell. And now for our 2019 Store of the Year, Cadillac House in Shanghai, done by Gensler. I'd like to say congratulations to the 49th International Design Awards Class of 2019. So the Retail Design Institute is made up of chapters and some of them around the world. Our Brazil chapter hosts their own design awards every year. So forgive me if I completely butcher some of the names of the locations, but I am going to try my best to highlight some of the awards from the Retail Design Institute Brazil chapter. Almaria Plus Size. Alta Excelencia Diagnostica. And now, isn't that one of the coolest child pediatrics locations you've ever seen? I just had to point that out. Unfortunately, we don't have one of them here to talk about this, but I love, love, love that design. Corrientes 348. Encontre Vinos. Galpão Etna. Live. Showroom Das. Tanya Belhos. Vivara. And now I'd like to introduce Ryan Bravda, and Ryan will present the OMA Awards.
All right. Yeah. First we have in the snack products category, temporary display, the 2019 Camp Backyard Summer Mega, produced by Packaging Corporation of America. Next in the beverages and beer category, again, temporary display, Budweiser Copper Lager Barrel Bin, produced by Rapid Displays. In the specialty retailers and services category for semi-permanent display, the Davidoff AVO Unexpected Trunk Cigar Merchandiser, produced by Great Northern In-Store. Those are my cigars as well, so I'm partial to this one. In the supermarket category, temporary display, Kroger Apple Stack Wow Display, produced by Intermark Communications. In the mass merchandise category, temporary display, Game of Thrones, the final season, Walmart Wow Display, produced by Origin LLC. In In the home and garden category, temporary display, the Milwaukee Tool Power Tool Pallet Train, produced by Menasha. Now for the global awards, I'll turn it over to Leo van der Polder here.
Well, first of all, guys, you are doing a great job. Cynthia, Ryan, great. The Shop Global Awards, welcome. We have 93 entries from creative teams across the globe. 21 categories are divided in two main areas. It's on market segments, where is design used in retail, and also in means, how design is used in retail. We are in the couple of pictures which you are going to see is a small selection of winners from Australia, New Zealand, Brazil, Greater China, UK, Ireland, and USA. The first one is in the category alcohol and tobacco. It's POP and in-store promotion. It's 19 crimes, get your mug shot taken and join the gang. It's produced by Mike in Australia, and it's produced for Treasury Wine Estates. And it's originating from the country contest Shop Australia, New Zealand. You see the display, and the next picture will show you the integration with promotions, packaging, and tasting. You know, take your picture, put it on the bottle, and, you know, drink your own 19 crimes. The next one is in the category innovation. It's a shop in a shop, Casa Conectada from Samsung. It's produced by Chile, Brazil. It's produced for Samsung Electronica da Amazonia. And it was originated in the contest of Popeye Brazil. This is the area, and you see the several possibilities in touch and try in the next slides. Great thing, but we will hear more about it later on. The other one is in the category digital, mobile, and interactive media. It's Walmart Oral-B end cap. It's produced by P&G China, and it's produced for P&G China, and it comes from the originating contest from Shop Greater China. But you can see also, when you take a look at the picture, they also use, let's say, the shopper insights, you know, stopping, trying, and holding and buying. So they really integrate shopper insights into this POP. The next one is category food, grocery, and convenience. One of my favorite brands, it's come from the Netherlands. It's permanent POP, it's Heineken, the Zero Zone. It's produced by Shop Equipment LTD. It's produced for Heineken Ireland, and the originating contest country came from Popeye UK and Ireland. It's pretty clear this is our zero zone. So they almost claim a small part of the category. The next one is specialty store concepts. It's Department Solutions. It's produced by In-Store Screen LLC, and it is produced for Oak Farms. And the originating content country was the Shop OMA Awards. And you see here the several touch points where they use digital signage and digital communications around the store. It's in fish, it's in meat. Next. Bread, baked daily. in cosmetics, health and body. So a lot of, you know, good touch points based on in-store screens. I will also like to say thank you to all our judges who made this possible, from the OMA Awards and the Global Awards. I know how much time it will cost. It's always voluntary time, but I really appreciate what all the judges are doing, not only in the shop area, but also in the RDI area.
Thank you, Leo and Ryan. And thank you to all of our panelists. We're now gonna open up to questions from our panelists. We actually have one or something directed at you, Leo. Ariel is saying, who wouldn't want their own mugshot on a bottle of wine? Do you know how often the photographer is there to take the photos and if they measure the success for that installation with sales?
I don't know for sure if they measure it with sales, but you know, it's an in-store promotion. It gives, let's say, more experience to the shopper when he is in the store. So I noticed that I know that people are stopping and taking their picture because it's fun.
It is very fun. I think that was an awesome promotion to do for 19 Crimes, to have your own face on a bottle of wine.
Yeah, but also the integration, you know, you see POP together with in-store promotion, you know, so they're two different means, but, you know, they are making the message for the shopper much easier and easy to digest.
Absolutely. What a great promotion. So I'm going to direct my first question to Stefan of Adefica. Tell us a little bit about Psycho Bunny and how the idea for this concept came to life. I really, really enjoy the design of this space. I think it's, you know, young and bright and colorful. And I'd love to hear a little bit more from you.
Thank you, Cynthia. This project started in 2018, and it was Psycho Bunny was operating since around 2005, mainly wholesale. And they had some franchisees in Latin America and in Japan. And they had just started their e-com business maybe 1 hour, 1 year prior. So everything was kind of fresh and new. And in some ways, there was no legacy systems, no legacy store ops that bounded the design of this new store concept. It was really their first time in own store retail. So that was kind of an advantage. Because it really pushed us to have an outside-in approach, to really go to, yes, the brand pillars that they had, but also findings from market analysis, studies of user experience and personas, and understanding where their customer was at that time, and begin wholesale, and they were in Bloomingdale's and Nordstrom and in some select third-party stores. They had a limited understanding of who their customer was. And actually the pop-up was kind of a surprise opportunity that they had. And again, being really agile and fast on their feet, we hopped in and we basically had a couple of months to design, fabricate and open up the store, just to open up in time for the peak Thanksgiving holiday shopping period. So the, you know, it was a great experience for them because it was the first time to operate a store. So it was low risk, low capex investment. And it really helped them to start, you know, getting their muscles on the store operations side and then getting some really, really interesting insights and feedback from customers in a real live format. So it kind of, for them, it was kind of a proof of concept of having physical stores, and their relationship with digital online sales and wholesale was really, really, really interesting.
Stefan, I actually have a question coming in for you from Diana Revkin. And she's asking, which area of Miami was this installation? And was the client also considering it a test for physical retail?
Well, absolutely, it was a test. And actually the pop-up concept has become their prime focus format for testing out new markets elsewhere. So, and so this is in Aventura Mall in North Miami Beach, I believe. What's interesting is that typically when we open retail shops, and I guess in my experience with other retailers in the past, there was always often like a regional approach. You would open up in New England area or in Florida or in California. And you know the retailers would build a critical mass of stores within that region. It kind of made sense for distribution. It made sense for store managers, district managers, and even marketing. And in this case here, and again, going back to the fact that they are wholesale and their online business is really picking up, what they've been doing is parachuting these pop-ups in different locations across the states, testing out really new markets with new demographic profiles, and then discovering that new clientele, how they've captured the clientele and engaged with them. And that's helped them to evolve their product offering and brand messaging in a very, very thoughtful and meaningful way.
Okay, great. We have one more question coming in for you from Paul Packwich, asking, how were the colored translucent pedestals used in marketing and what product was displayed?
The overall concept was really based on pop art, and actually the pop-up store is really the retail format that we have that really pushes the color envelope to a high level of or high intensity. And that's really intentional to really create quick market awareness, brand awareness in new cities and new markets. So it was more of a visual pop to make somebody stop in the mall and really want to go inside versus having specific tailoring on the product. And even having the neon pink neon lights on the wall, normally that's kind of a no-no because you are affecting the eyes in terms of the actual product that's underneath it. But it was a really cute to 1970s pop-up culture art installations, a bit like Dan Flavin. So really going back to some of the brand pillars of the founders who were really inspired by pop art to develop this juxtaposition of very, very bold colors and striped motif in all their products.
Absolutely. Paul also says, by the way, that's a gorgeous way to display product while maintaining visual clarity. We have another question coming in from Ariel saying, without their own store design department, which teams are your main collaborators at Psycho Bunny?
It's been marketing, store ops, and the overall, the district manager and some outside consultants for visual merchandising, for example. But it's been a very, very small team, and actually they've been expanding just because their business has been going leaps and bounds since this store opened in November 2018. We've gone from one store to 22 stores. Like, we have 7 stores under construction right now under a pandemic. So it's a really good time for them, actually. They've been doing well.
That's great. Thank you so much, Stefan. I'm going to direct the next question to Pablo Braga. Pablo, let me pull up your slides. Can you tell us a little bit about your designs here? And were there any challenges or difficulties in putting this together?
Yeah, Cynthia. Hi. The connected house was born with a very challenging briefing. We should demonstrate how Samsung products can help life of the customers, creating a new model of life, a new connected world with cell phone, with televisions, with laundry, with refrigerators, with air conditioner, all of products that Samsung have on has on their portfolio. How can we demonstrate this at the store? So for this, we try to create a time machine. What's a time machine? To move to the future, but we cannot create now the time machine. So we create the house inside the store. And our mainly challenge for this project is how to create a house inside the store that doesn't block the view, that can then demonstrate all the Samsung products and allows an innovative customer experience. That's our main challenge of this project. And difficult is the time of implementation. And like every retail project, we have only 3-4 weeks to implement this project. And we are talking about to create a house inside the store. We have to build the walls. Okay, we don't have walls, but we have a structure, we have floor, we have furnitures, we have mainly the connectivity. In Brazil, we have a difficult with quality internet. We have no, we haven't a good quality of internet. So for us, that's our best, that's our biggest difficult, how to create in a short time a house inside the store. And another difficult, we installed this house while the stores is open, is working. And every day we should manage the time to make the installation during the night and to keep the opening store for the next day. So we only have the time of the night to go in with the installation. And we take around 4 days to finish this job. So it's a very difficult and it's a very challenge. It's a big challenge for us to make it so fast. But I think it was a good job. It's a good result.
Yes, it's absolutely beautiful. Do you have any insights on the results of your shop and shop?
Yeah, what we heard from the partner, the retail stores where we installed this project, they have a increase of 30% to stay in store, to customers staying at the space. And we have a 20% of increase of sales.
That's amazing. That's amazing. It's always great to hear insights like that on how your designs and how, you know, your completed project have impacted the sales for your client. Absolutely. Thank you very much, Pablo. Do any of the panelists have any questions for Pablo?
No, I think it's a great, it's pretty clear.
Yeah, I think so too. So we will move on to Brian of RHDC to talk about specs.
Everyone.
Hi, Brian.
Hey, how's it going? So this was kind of an interesting one. This is a local independent business in San Diego, California, which is where we are based. It's a optometrist office as well as an optical store. And they have a couple of locations in San Diego already. But for this next location, this new location, they wanted to go in kind of a more polished vibe, but not to lose the integrity of their kind of indie brand. So there was no desire to go in a corporate direction. However, they did want to have the polish because their first couple of locations are very mom and pop, very DIY, and they sell very expensive frames, you know, $500 to $1,000 and up. And so they wanted a location where those products and that type of product could really be showcased. And with speaking with the owner, she really liked minimal contemporary design, very Asian influenced. as do I. And so, you know, we all know as designers, we have to be well-versed in all design styles, but sometimes you'll connect with that client where you guys really just kind of see eye to eye on personal taste. And so this one was really kind of an exercise of editing, you know, and I think the inclination is always to kind of add more and more, like, oh, here's some empty space. And so here was really just kind of taking away. You'll notice there's not even really much interior signage. There's no interior branding. And so the thought there was, obviously there's exterior branding. People already know where they are, and it's not to be kind of beat over the head with, you know, the brand's identity, just to keep kind of more of that, again, indie kind of boutique feel, but in a clean, polished way. Also though, this client was very fun. And so we wanted to make sure that, you know, sometimes when you go too clean or minimal, it can become sterile or too serious. And so we made sure to just kind of implement, you know, little touches of whimsy here and there that really reflected the owner's personality.
Absolutely. One of the things that drew me to this design was that contemporary look. I thought it was very classy and represented the brand really well. But then I loved how it's kind of fun and playful in the exam room with the different eyes all over the wall. You know, you have a nice mixture of the fun and playful side and the contemporary vibe that really holds true to the product being sold in store. You already touched a little bit on what the influences are were for this project, and you know, and that the owner shared the same kind of loves that you did. So that was really exciting to hear. Did you have any challenges or difficulties with this project at all?
Yeah, I mean, I think within, you know, with every project, there's always challenges. This one definitely had several, you know, a couple that kind of stand out. So this is actually a very cool new shopping center in kind of North County, you know, just north of San Diego, called One Paseo. And the shopping center is great. It's beautiful. They were really going for, you know, to capture kind of that California coastal vibe. And so everything about it, from, you know, just the look of the landscaping and the exterior is great. They've got a really nice product, vendor and brand mix. And so what was really cool about this location, especially for this local independent client, is there is a very curated tenant list of national brands, but then other independent San Diego brands that have a little bit of a following. So that was a really nice mix. I would say the challenges were, you know, as we're looking at kind of like these standard, you know, kind of new mall spaces, we were always working with kind of 20-foot widths, store frontages. Well, here they're kind of starting to make them a little bit smaller and smaller. And so our overall frontage was only 19 feet, which doesn't really sound like that big of a challenge with only a foot difference. But for the real functionality of the other side of this business being the optometrist's office, is we had to make sure that not just there was enough room for the retail showroom, but also the functionality of all the exam rooms and leaving, you know, adequate clearances around everything. So I'd say just the space planning was kind of a challenge. Also just the, because this was a new construction and new tenants were going in kind of staggered at different times, we would be going through construction and just getting through with like finishes and, you know, hanging the floating shelves, and construction was going on next door, which would literally cause cracks in the ceiling, cracks in the, you know, finished drywall, you know, things that kind of shift. So it was more of kind of like a logistical and kind of implementation challenge for that, with just the other tenants doing construction as well.
Absolutely. Yeah, that sounds like a little bit of a challenge, just a little bit of a challenge.
It was a little stressful for the client, especially when they were already open and construction was going on next door and things were still shifting as customers were in the store. So.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Do any of our panelists have any questions for Brian, Leo?
Brian, what did you also need to work with, let's say, sustainable requirements from the retailer?
Yeah, we did our best. So we actually worked with a fabricator just south of the border in Tijuana. And they do really, really great work down there, and they work exclusively with natural materials. And so nothing was, you know, HPL or you know, any more synthetic materials. Everything was natural. I would like to say that that was with more intention, but honestly, I think it's just the way that their business and their shop is set up down there. It's what they are more accustomed and comfortable to work with. And so a lot of times it aligns with kind of our company ethos as well as our clients.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And to our audience, don't forget there is a Q&A at the bottom of your screen. Please feel free to type in any questions at any time for any of our panelists. Next up, I will talk to Dan and Rhonda about their design. Dan and Rhonda, tell us a little bit about your design, aside from the fact that those are Ryan's cigars.
Sure, go ahead, Ron. Dan?
No, you go ahead, Dan.
Well, I'll kick it off with just the client. We've done a lot of work with Davidoff in the past, more on permanent merchandisers. And they came to us with a challenge to help with the launch of the AVO cigar line. And as always is the fun in the industry is they had a much tighter budget than we had dealt with in the past on with permanent merchandisers for them. So to really launch this brand, in stores with an execution that would last 3 to 6 months. I'll let Rhonda highlight from the design perspective how we tackled that and yet still bring the brand to life.
Yeah, so it was interesting when they first came into this concept, they wanted to first let that they could buy actual live trunks and then fit them with some corrugate and display the product. And then again, as Dan said, that was a little too budget restricted for them. So we came up with an alternative that, you know, because they wanted this to really last for a while in their stores. And as we all know, corrugate is meant to be a temporary substrate that doesn't, you know, 6 to 8 weeks, you know, is your typical run. So we just had to kind of come up with an interesting way to figure out to meet their needs, support these fat boxes, which, you know, the boxes are the heavy part, not the cigars. And then add in the real life brass hinges and lock and leather strap. And when you're putting that onto corrugate, the concern is it just gonna pull out? Is it gonna rip out? Is it gonna do, you know, all these different kinds of things. So we really had to engineer the corrugate, for lack of a better term, beefy, in other words, to hold all of this brass handles and things like that in and get it to where it would not rip out, because when this went to the store, it was actually closed with the lock for the brass lock, and the retailer actually had to unlock it with the key to open it up. So it was kind of a neat idea that they had, and then the product would be displayed obviously as it's displayed in there. Davidoff ended up taking this to, I believe, a cigar convention in Las Vegas, which, you know, that's where the cigar, Ryan, for future reference, that's where the cigar conventions are. And it was a neat little, they ended up, had a little interview with the video on it to bring in some hype about this new brand that they were launching and get it out into the people's minds and everything.
That's great. I love it. Leo, Ryan, any questions, any points on that? I do understand fully from my past life in visual, the concerns with applying the brass and the leather to the corrugate. That is definitely a challenge, and something that really has to be done well. In order to work well when executed and when shown wherever, whether it be at a show or in store, the last thing you want is these pieces falling apart. So kudos to you on that part of the design and figuring out how to do that and do it well.
Hold on.
Did you have?
Oh, sorry. Go ahead, sorry, Leo. Cynthia. Sorry.
Nope, you go right ahead.
Okay. So, Rhonda, how did you do the implementation?
Of what do you mean?
The display into the stores. How did it go?
It went really well. Just as a side note, the sales guy, he actually does own his own cigar store, which is how he kind of got in this. So he got one for his shop and they put it on the counter and they just said people were coming in and, they were trying. It's kind of one of those things where you're like, you don't really want people to touch it because you don't want it to fall apart.
They
were kind of enamored by how, real life trunk looking it was. And unfortunately, there's not a back photo of it, but it even had some of that like vintage look on the back with Davidoff's logo and everything. So it was, people were coming up and they're like realizing, oh, this is just, corrugated. It's not, a real trunk, because that was the view that it was giving, from a distance. And they were, it was really cool to see people, even though it wasn't meant to be an engaged hands-on type of display, that people were, kind of messing with all the different hardware on the display.
So was this a one-off display, or was it or did you produce it for multiple locations?
Well, we produced it for multiple locations. And then each individual, it's just works just like other POP, the stores order, which one they want. And well, this was their only option, but whether they wanted it or not, depending on size and display rooms in their facilities.
Yeah, you touched on what one of my comments was going to be. I had two is when, you're making this out of temporary corrugated materials and putting on the real materials, it's so unique. People are going to, in the POP world, you got to think about how people are going to want to go in there and actually close that thing up and hold
right.
it, like a right. suitcase. So how do you stay semi-perm in that world? Yet, no, everybody's going to walk up and try to grab the handle.
Yeah, and that's what, like I said, like why we had to really, make it
or
for those, both of those reasons for, where it would pull out. Because the other challenge that we had was the assembly part of this, putting, each one of those little things had to be screwed in and had like a lock of the post locks on the back. And it wasn't quite, easy to get, they had to like really bend and work themselves a few different ways to get the hinges and things on this thing. So, but we got through it obviously, and it turned out to be a really nice display. And I think Davidoff they were super happy with it.
We did. It was about 200 was the run to hit the cigar dealers with it. So yeah, pretty good quantity that, if we had ended up the path of procuring trunks, it would have been quite expensive. So this really fit the bill.
Absolutely. What a great solution.
Especially when you're dealing with a client that you've been selling permanent work to for so long, they have that expectation. And now you have to try to match it with a different budget and different material. So
that is always the challenge in figuring out that entire solution that exactly lives up to it. And that was, again, they ended up being extremely well pleased. They love the idea of the real hardware instead of, many times you can scale it down and almost mock it up, but that really provided the great blend. It provided the challenge, as Rhonda described, to how does this all fit together? But it definitely fit their needs and they were well pleased with it.
That's great. That's great. Thank you. I'm going to go next to Henrik Andersen. Henrik, welcome. I'd love to hear from you a little bit about your designs here.
Yes, hello.
Hi. So can you tell us a little bit about your concepts here and your designs and what you did?
Yes, so InstaScreen is a company that's 15 years old. We have been working with like how we can change the retail environment to utilize newer technologies at the same time not having regular sized screens. We want to have a direct replacement of the usually printed signs in the stores. Since 1 year ago, we are part of Lenovo, and we wanted to develop the store of the future, and we teamed up with Seat to Table Oaks Farms in Naples, Florida. And we developed a full line of total replacement screens that could replace print. On the picture we see here is that we wanted to utilize pillars to have menu boards. Due to the pillars had a limited size and width, we developed a 48 inch by a 12 inch screen that goes on the pillars with the menus. We also wanted to incorporate some screens that that are square. So we also added square screens that are 33 inch. And we developed in-aisle screens that we call them. They are double-sided screens that goes on top of the gondolas. With this, we incorporate a different type of sensor technology as well. So there are cameras in all screens. Those cameras are measuring people flow, movement, inventory management, interest of products. So we can see how many people are looking at what product, how long time they're looking at the product. Based on how far they are from the product, we can see how interested they are in the product. We can see if they pick up the product, and we can cross-check that with the cashier, how much they're selling of that product.
That's great. So that really goes into the insights on the results. I mean, your product truly gives them insights into everything that they're selling, which is really pretty awesome. So I do love that. Did you have any challenges or difficulties with this project at all?
We had it quite easy because we built up everything during the store built up. So we had a lot of time. We had almost a year to finish it. So now everything flowed very quick. Our key thing when we built this is that it should be easily retrofit. So it went very easy. The flow was very nice. All these screens are also daisy chained. That means that if you look at the fresh bread baked daily, all of them are run by one computer. So that's why we can incorporate all of them to work as one.
That's amazing. And let me tell you, one year for a retail project is also quite amazing. I'm sure all of our panelists can attest to that one. Very often we do not get 1 year to work on projects.
No, it was totally empty. When we came in there, there was like only cement on the floor. So wow. We have helped them with like everything from store design to technology.
Henrik, I have a question coming in from Eugene asking if you use AI in your smart screen.
Yes, we do. We have about 80% of the screens we are producing have intelligence in them.
That's great. What a great question. So I have a general question to all of the panelists. That just came in. How much do you consider installation and assembly times required by store teams? I am often challenged with having to dumb down designs because stores don't have the budgets to assemble and install fixtures. Anyway.
We don't do the fixtures at the Insta screen. That's in this case, it was Lozier and the local store themselves built the fixtures. If I just answer how long it will take to have like an installation like the ones we have in front of you, that's probably like 2 hours installation.
Wow. Okay. Brian, Stefan. What are your thoughts on that? It is a thing where, you know, it does again take extra time to put all of these fixtures into place. And I know that you probably have great partners that you work with, but you know, what are your thoughts on that? And have you ever had to dumb down the design a little bit to make the assembly and install easier?
Yeah, I would say we definitely take the time to install and assemble into consideration. I would say with most of our projects and most of our designs, obviously it's going to kind of depend what the project is and who the client is. A lot of times we are able to assemble the entire project team, you know, from, you know, the contractor down to the installers. And if that's the case, you know, we do have some very capable and competent partners, and we can almost kind of design to their strengths if we know what they're doing. But a lot of times we're not in control of that. And like, maybe it is like an internal install team, or the client selected their own contractor or their own install team because they're the cheapest. And so we do have to kind of make things as easy as possible. And just to kind of relate it back to the specs project, for things that are kind of just like time and labor intensive, there was an accent wall that looked like louvers or slats to kind of have like that kind of Asian inspired kind of soji wall. Instead of installing every slat individually, that was actually, we had the fabricator make that as a solid panel. And so the panel goes up as one piece, or maybe we'll do several larger panels instead of just individual pieces, because that is time consuming. And also you're kind of relying on your contractor or installer to really act as more of as like a finished carpenter or an artist. And a lot of times they're not. And so we also put a lot of work into our drawings to make sure that there's very good reference instructions. You know, almost if you buy something at IKEA, there's words and pictures to kind of describe, but you never really know. So there definitely have been some times, I wouldn't say where we've dumbed it down, but we've thought about the end product and how it's, you know, going to be put together in advance, so we don't run into those issues. Because otherwise they will make, and when I say they, I usually mean the contractor, they'll make executive decisions on the ground in the field and tell you about it afterwards. And then you get on site to check it out and you go, what happened here? So anything we can do to kind of combat that proactively, we try to do up front.
Yeah, Dan, you seem to be nodding your head quite a bit to what Brian's saying. Do you have anything you want to add to that?
I mean, yeah, I'll echo, and I know we're more on the point of purchase, but there's definitely that consideration of how the activation is going into the store, how it's going to be activated, and designing for that. That's critical, because there are some teams where you need to, yes, there's probably a little bit more upfront costs, but in the end, it gets set up because it's just easy to take out of the box, set and be ready, plug in if there's electronics. But it's just keeping it as simple as possible, because you're right. As Brian said, you don't, you don't know what's going to end up on store, you know, that parts missing, not set up right, et cetera. So you have to have, make it simple and have some great instructions as well. I know we do a lot with even video instructions of late, where people can scan a code and see a video of how it should all get put together.
Oh, that's amazing. That's a great idea. I've worked with displays quite a bit in the past, mm-hmm. and you know, putting together PDF sheets that can be printed out and or emailed to the stores, so that many a times with displays, stores are setting them up themselves and sales associates are the ones setting up the displays. And yes, there can be some headaches and some issues there as well. So very, very good insight. Henrik, yeah. I have two questions that have come in for you. The first one is, are there any issues in terms of privacy concerns with cameras and the consumers?
I've been in certain regions, mostly Europe. They are not very willing to get the cameras in there. People get scared of them. US, it's more acceptable. The cameras are not taking pictures of the people, so they look more like clouds or things like that. So we don't take any, we don't record any events. We don't get faces. We don't do face recognition. But yes, there are people that when they see the camera, they're thinking that they're getting recorded and saved. So yes, that's an obstacle that we have to overcome. We are working with multiple sensors as well. The camera inside is an analytics camera. So it's not a video camera as you have in your cell phone and so on. It's more advanced using IR. So it can read in a different way. So it reads movements, count people, but it doesn't really go into the depth, taking like a four high res image of you. And when you, about the question about installation, I just want to get one thing in here. All the screens where we're doing was very important that it could be retrofit. So we have been working very close with both Lowesier and Maddox on the American market. So all the mounts and everything. So you get like, you can install these screens extremely quick. The thing that could take a longer time when it comes to electronics is to get the power there.
Absolutely. Okay, the second question for you is, how much does it cost to equip all stores with screens, and how did you calculate the efficiency of this technologies?
So if we take this store as an example, this was about $50,000 in hardware. About efficiency, that's something we work every day with. So that depends very much about what kind of product it is. We did a similar installation for a company selling allergy medicine. And we put it up into a pharmaceutical location, and the sales uplift was close to 70%.
Right.
That solution, we used cameras, we used external data to expose how much pollen it was in the air. We used the counting of how many people were interested and so on. So it really depends. It could be a big difference from having a screen with a Coca-Cola than having a screen with like an iPad or something like that. It's more expensive, have more features. So most of our clients, when they see the screens, when you have a product that needs to be explained, and when it gets explained, you buy it. This store is totally organic. So they're explaining the benefits of like having organic jams, organic peanuts, make your own peanuts. So that has been very good for them.
Hey, Cynthia, if I may add as well to Ariel's question, I don't see it really as dumbing down. More in my experience, it's also a great opportunity to really deep dive in the industrial design of the fixtures. You know, simplification, optimization, is actually, I think, a good thing. Less material, faster times, a more optimal way or a smarter way of building it. I find, has always been a worthwhile investment when the volume is there. And again, I think it's being very cognizant of the site conditions and what the capacities of assembly and building offsite versus onsite. So, it's a great challenge. And actually, in the past months, our challenge has been that typically we would have a chief installer fly into a store to help install and help a GC explain the processes or methods, and even having some of the visual merchandisers or marketing team come in and assist the team that's opening up the store. With the pandemic, travel was not a good thing, either not allowed or just a bad idea in the context. So really, we really had to create either walkthroughs with the smartphone or creating more clear instructions to help people understand what they're supposed to build and how they're supposed to merchandise. So that's, those are fairly simple things that needed to be done, but just needed to be thought out because our whole habits of building have been kind of out of whack in the past months.
Absolutely. The pandemic has definitely caused quite a few issues with all of these things. in relation to retail and how things get done and how things get built. I have to say, one of the things that I love about having the Retail Design Institute and SHOP collaborating on events like this is having a panel as diverse as what we have in front of us today. My opinion, having been on both sides of the industry, having worked on visual merchandising, but also having been on the architectural design, it is extremely important more and more that the designers work together with the POP and display manufacturers. The designers come up with the initial concept for the store, but it is the visual merchandising companies, the POP and display companies, that are the ones that continue to keep that store looking the way the designer originally planned. So it's such a great thing to, you know, be able to have this collaboration and be able to have all of you designers together on the screen to talk together. And, you know, I think that our audience can clearly see how much all of this is needed together. You know, it's amazing. Collaboration is amazing. I want to, you know, definitely thank everybody for taking part today in this presentation. I want to thank everybody for joining. So thank you for joining us today. I do also want to point out that SHOP is now accepting submittals for the OMAs and the Global Awards. So please get your submissions in. And as well, the Retail Design Institute is also accepting submittals for the 50th International Design Competition. If you look into your chat bar for all of the attendees, you will see the links being posted to both websites to go in and find out a little bit more about the awards and take a look and see if you have any projects that you can submit. Both SHOP and the Retail Design Institute really appreciate all of you attending today. Yeah. Thank you, Leo. Thank you, Ryan. And thank you to all of our panelists. We really, really appreciate you all joining us today. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Cynthia.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks. Thank you. See you next time. Bye-bye.
Have a great day, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.